It is a joy to be with you in the house of the Lord this day. We begin with a time for announcements, praises, and concerns. First, I want to remember to share we have two big birthday celebrations today. Helene Zeman, am I allowed to say how old you are, Helene?
Yes.
Helene turned 75 yesterday or today, depending on which birth certificate and mother you believe. And Tommy Anderson, who said he might be called away to go pick up someone for the funeral home, which he still does at the age of 97 today.
Shirley's.
Oh, it's Shirley's birthday too. It's a big day. Yeah. I bet you Shirley will let me tell how old she is though. people who give generously of their time and their gifts in order to lead God's church faithfully and well, and they are much appreciated for all of their service. Thank you. I had a call from Carlos this week. He was so pleased with La Caminante, which has started back with the start of the spring semester. The Wednesday night group has all moved to Tuesday night, and the Tuesday night groups both went well. First, the dinner and reflection group, and then he had 13 students from Bell State come out for the 8 o'clock study. He was just so excited by how excited the students were to be there. So grateful to God for Carlos's ministry. And he, on the Sundays that he is not here, he is always out ministering elsewhere. So he is out. I can't remember which location he's at. I can't keep up with all of his locations, but he travels a lot. The Stricklands will host the Search Class Covered Dish Dinner on Saturday, March 28th at 5:30. And I think I have announced everything on all of my pages. Please forgive me, congregation and Jesus, if I have forgotten something. And we are now going to enter into our time of worship with special music from our fabulous children's choir. Oh, Marlon.
Thank you. Morning.
Morning.
Please join me in the responsive call to worship and the unison opening prayer. Come, all who are poor in spirit. Come, all who mourn. Come, all who are meek. Come, all who hunger and thirst after righteousness.
Come, all who would be merciful. Come, all who would be pure in heart. Come, all who would be peacemakers.
Let's come together, the weak, the simple, the powerless, the foolish.
Let us confess that the source of our life is Christ Jesus. Let us worship the God of every blessing.
Bible school leader, and very valued soprano of the choir. Did you hear that?
No.
Amy Kellen!
Thank you.
Let us pray. Holy God, your blessings are abundant, and your wisdom exceeds our grasp. Fill us with your Spirit as we hear your word this day, that we may be justice seekers and peacemakers, sharing your life among those who are forgotten, the weak, the persecuted, and revealing to all your glory. Amen. Our Old Testament reading this morning is from the book of Micah, chapter 6, lines 1 through 8, and it's found in your pew Bible on page 816. First, God challenges Israel. Hear what the Lord says. Rise, plead your case before the mountains, and let the hills hear your voice. Hear, you mountains, the controversy of the Lord, and you enduring foundations of the earth. For the Lord has a controversy with his people, and he will contend with Israel. O my people, what have I done to you? In what have I wearied you? Answer me. For I brought you up from the land of Egypt, and redeemed you from the house of slavery. And I sent before you Moses, Aaron, and Miriam. O my people, remember now what King Balak of Moab devised, and what Balaam son of Beor answered him, and what happened from Shittim to Gilgal, that you may know the saving acts of the Lord. And now the people ask, and God reveals what he requires. With what shall I come before the Lord and bow myself before God on high? Shall I come before him with burnt offerings, with calves a year old? Will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams, with 10,000s of rivers of oil? Shall I give my firstborn for my transgression, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul? He has told you, O mortal, what is good. And what does the Lord require of you but to do justice and to love kindness and to walk humbly with your God? Now I invite you to honor God and stand in body or spirit for the gospel reading. It's from chapter 5 of the book of Matthew, lines 1 through 12, and it is found at page 4 of your pew Bible. When Jesus saw the crowds, he went up the mountain, and after he sat down, his disciples came to him. Then he began to speak and taught them, saying, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven. For in the same way, they persecuted the prophets who were before you. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
You may be seated. This week, as I was reflecting on people throughout our church history who have incarnated the readings of today's scriptures, one of the persons who came to mind when I fit the description was Richard Allen. Richard Allen is believed to have been born in Delaware as a slave, and he was born in 1760 or so. And he was the first slave to receive manumission in Pennsylvania. And that came as a result of a Methodist preacher who came and preached at the plantation where he lived. He converted to Christ, and so did his owner. And because of that conversion, his owner allowed him to earn wages so that he was ultimately able to buy his way out of slavery. Interestingly to note, I'll continue Richard Allen's story in just a moment, our own church, Wesley Church, was founded by Freeborn Garrison, a white Methodist preacher who got the name Freeborn because upon inheriting slaves from his family's estate, set them free. And when he came to preach down the street at the Green, the market square of the day, the first thing the crowds did was throw tomatoes and worse things at him. And it was the city fathers standing on either side of him that convinced the crowd to listen, and what ultimately led to where we are sitting today. And so Richard Allen and Freeborn Garrison were contemporaries. And Richard Allen was one of the black Methodist preachers who preached up and down the peninsula and around the region, and is ultimately the founder of the African Methodist Episcopal Church. You may think that sounds familiar because we have several of those right in town. We have one over on Division Street, which many years ago was the St. Paul's Methodist Church. It was a Christian Scientist church, and then it became the AME Church. And of course, the Mount Zion AME Church on Queen Street. And so Richard Allen was praying in worship in St. George's Chapel in Philadelphia. And on their knees in prayer were black and white Methodists in worship. The black Methodists had not gone up to the balcony for that service. And the ushers came to the conclusion that they were duty-bound to remove the black Methodists from their, on their knees in prayer, and bodily drag them out of the sanctuary. It was then that Richard Allen declared that while Methodism was certainly for him, the way that this church was organized was not. And so began the African Methodist Episcopal Church. And if you go into Mount Zion AME on Queen Street and look at the stained glass that they have at the front of their church, you will see a blacksmith anvil in the stained glass. And the first time I was in that church and I looked at the stained glass, I thought, I have got to know why there is an anvil in the stained glass. And that is because the very first gathering of Richard Allen's African Methodist Episcopal Church was in a blacksmith shop. And so that has become a symbol of the AME Church. We continue to be part of the Pan-Methodist family. We continue to have all kinds of relationships and ties with our sisters and brothers across the Methodist soup, so to speak. There's lots of branches. Richard Allen was the earliest to have the kind of blessedness that Jesus speaks of in terms of American Methodism. Because he was willing to be persecuted
for righteousness' sake, and to trust that Jesus and his church would continue and thrive for all of God's people. Jesus' teaching in the Beatitudes is his first sermon that he preaches in the Gospel of Matthew. It's the next chapter after he begins his public ministry. His preaching concludes in the 25th chapter of Matthew. That is his last sermon before the Passion, Crucifixion, and Resurrection. And so it's interesting to note that the beginning of his public ministry and the end of his public ministry both make it clear that those who are oppressed in human kingdoms are blessed in God's kingdom. That the Son of Man is judging the nations by the measure of how we care for those on the margins. As I was studying this week, I read a scholar named James Allison who describes the Beatitudes in a way that I hadn't considered. As I thought more about this over the course of the morning, I think I might have considered it a long time ago and it gotten lost in my thinking, but it felt fresh to me this time. What I realized is that I have been thinking of the Beatitudes, blessed are the poor in spirit, blessed are those who mourn, blessed are the meek, as a kind of promise that God is with us in the hardest of times, and that we in turn should be with people in those spaces with them when they are walking through such times. And that is indeed true. What I hadn't really been focused on is that the Beatitudes are used as examples of how all of God's people are called to be. The people who are lifted up as being closest to God are all marginal and all deeply dependent upon God for their daily bread. People who have a certain relationship to others, which might be described as precarious. The poor in spirit are poor relative to people who might use power and wealth against them. Those who mourn are those who are in a relationship of vulnerability because of some loss or an overbearing situation. The meek are meek in the midst of a social order that despises meekness and values strength. The merciful refuse to be involved in a vengeful relation to the other, which is to say they don't insist on their rights over against another person. The pure in heart have acquired their purity of heart with difficulty in the midst of a world which does not encourage it. And the peacemakers are those who so often end up being blamed by both sides for not sharing in the violence, with each side seeing them as betraying the cause. Those who are persecuted for righteousness is a foreshadowing, of course, of the one, Jesus, who will pay the ultimate price in being persecuted for righteousness and dying as the ultimate and final sacrifice for us. The key feature of blessedness is that it involves a deliberately chosen and cultivated source of life, which is not involved in the power and the violence of the world, and which, because of this fact, makes the ones living it vulnerable, persecuted for righteousness' sake. That is the center of Jesus' teaching in the Sermon on the Mount. If we turn to the end of Jesus' last discourse before his passion, in Matthew 25:31-46, the mirror image of this, we find the same teaching. In that famous passage of the Last Judgment, it is not defined in terms of belonging to this or that group or believing this or that doctrine. The judgment is presented in terms of the human relationships we have with vulnerable people. Those who hunger, thirst, are naked, sick, or imprisoned. Those who have understood or those who have seen their way out of the self-deception of the world which is blind to its vulnerable. It is the crucified and risen one who is the judge of the world, and the world is judged in the light of its relationship to the vulnerable. To take this a step further, if we are to follow Jesus, to be open to the Spirit making us more and more like Jesus, then we are not simply to care for the vulnerable, though that is certainly true. We are to become vulnerable ourselves. We are to become poor in spirit and meek, to mourn with those who mourn, and to be open to persecution for righteousness' sake. We are to be merciful, pure in heart, peacemakers. This is the teaching of Jesus, from the beginning to the end of the Gospel of Matthew. Perhaps this has always been as plain as the nose on my face. If you had asked me if these were indeed the virtues of a Christian, I would have agreed that indeed they are. And yet, I have to confess, I was not seeing this passage as deeply aspirational as I am seeing it now. If I were to name a great aspirational passage of what holiness looks like, I would have immediately chosen the fruits of the Spirit. Galatians 5:22-23. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, generosity, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Because let's be honest, I don't want to be persecuted. Do you? Who wants to be poor in spirit, or as Luke simply says, poor? Who wants to be meek in the world that values strength? And yet, this is the teaching of Jesus. And this is what we are promised leads to abundant life, leads us to walk in the ways of salvation, leads us to walk as Jesus walks. Jesus has flipped the measure of success for human beings flourishing together in community. Blessed are the poor in spirit who are oppressed by the human empire. Blessed are the nations who prioritize the care of the most vulnerable. This is the essence of the teaching from Micah, too. What does the Lord require of you but to do justice and to love kindness and to walk humbly with your God? Those words for justice and kindness in the Hebrew are the kinds of words that scholars love to debate about how to translate. The word mishpat for justice can mean so many things in our language, and mishpat can mean so many things in Hebrew. And so it's worth noting that mishpat, justice, is the kind that leads to restored relationship. A healing of brokenness is mishpat that God calls upon us. And hesed, loving kindness or mercy, is that kind of vulnerability that Jesus points to today. We are invited to see and be in the world in ways that leads us to the very edges, and indeed to join in with the community we find there. To join with those who are most vulnerable to the point of becoming vulnerable ourselves. And so as I sat and rested with that for a moment, to think about how that feels like good news to me, this is where I landed. It is a relief to be reminded that all of the striving and struggling and acquiring and consuming that the world tries so hard to convince us is the road to life, is a lie. That is not the path to abundant life. And I don't know about you, but sometimes I need to be reminded of that. I need to be reminded to set down all of the trappings that the commercials would have me pick up, and to let go of all of the striving and fretting, and to remember that the poor in spirit and the meek and the peacemakers are who we are called to be. And then I remember, too, that at the heart of the good news is always this, that the love of God extends to me, a sinner saved by grace, and indeed to each one of us. That there is nothing that I could say or do, no way in which I could succeed or fail that would make God stop loving me or us. And so even as we struggle and try to understand what it means to walk in the ways of Jesus and how difficult wrestling with those teachings may sometimes be, we always do so in the light of God's grace and love and mercy and never-ending kindness. That circle of light and love that is the Holy Spirit that carries us through each of our days. And so, my sisters and brothers, I invite you to reflect upon how it is that God leads us as a community that is embracing community and harmony with God. How is it that we together seek the kind of holiness that Jesus preaches to us this day? May it be so. I invite you to stand in body or in spirit as we sing together in faith. We sing number 2266. Here's bread, here is Christ.
What shall we come before the Lord this day? We come with a love of justice and a passion for sharing Christ's love. Let us walk in humble gratitude, offering to God a portion of the gifts that God freely shares with us, gifts for the healing of the world.
Thank you. Happy birthday.
Yes, happy birthday. Happy birthday. Yeah, Peace of Christ, Dan.
Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, our Lord Jesus took bread. He gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to the disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And when the supper was over, he took the cup. He gave thanks to you. He gave it to the disciples, and he said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant. It is poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice, in union with Christ's offering for us, as we sing together the mystery of faith.
Blood of Christ. Come.